So, welcome. Just to sort of get us in the spirit of this, I thought I'd play this little piece of video and audio. By the end of the semester, you'll understand every single thing they're saying in here and why they're saying it and what's going on. But for now, it's worth just watching it a little bit. And it doesn't look great out here, but the original movie doesn't look that great either. Anybody know what this is, by the way?
Alvo 2.
I think it even said on it.
Good radar data. Altitude now 33,500 feet. Give us a reading on the 12-02 program alarm. Roger, we got you. We're going at alarm. Roger, 230. 6 foot 2 5,
throttle down. 6 foot 2 5, throttle down. Roger, copy. 6 foot 2 5. We're still go. Altitude 20,000 feet. Same alarm, and it appears to come up when we have a 1650 ADA. Roger, copy. Eagle, Houston, we'll monitor. Delta A, beautifully. There's at least one more chair up here. If any of you guys in the back there, up in the front row. That's my favorite part when he says better than the simulator.
Just starting to come into view.
Roger. Title says we're go, altitude 9,200 feet.
830, you're looking great.
Descent rate 129 feet per second.
We copy. Roger. 47 degrees. Eagle looking great. You're dope.
Altitude 1600. 1400 feet, still looking very good.
Roger, 1202, we copy it.
35 degrees. 35 degrees, 750, coming down to 23. 700 feet, 21 down, 33 degrees. 100 feet, down to 19. 540 feet, down to 30, down to 15.
So this is what's happening in the cockpit at this moment. I'll say more about this in a little bit.
There's 400 feet down at 9. Take forward. 400 feet down at 4. 30, lift back down. They're tight on the normal velocity. 400 feet down 3.5. 47 forward. Hold up. 1 minute. 1.5 down. 70. 8. That's a shadow out there. 50 down to 2.5. 19 forward. Altitude velocity light. 10.5 down. 220 feet. 15 forward. Hover forward, coming down nicely, 200 feet, 4.5 down, 5.5 down. 6.5 down, 5.5 down. 9 forward. Good. 10.20 feet. 100 feet, 3.5 down, 9 forward. 5%. 30 bike. 75 feet. That is looking good. Down a half. 6 forward. 60 seconds. Lights on. Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. 30 feet down 2.5. Pick up some dust. 30 feet, 2.5 down. Nice shadow. 4 forward, 4 forward, drift into the right level. 6.5, 30 seconds forward. 8. Contact light. Okay, engine stop. APA under descent. Auto control, both auto descent, engine command override off. Engine arm off. 413 is in.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Houston, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Let's just do a little straight off observation. What do you see there? What's going on? You don't have to bring a lot of other knowledge. Just what did you just see?
So the one thing that I saw that I wasn't expecting to see was how much you can see the dust blowing when the thrusters are firing.
Okay. Yeah. So actually, a lot of the people on the ground said, we did this so many times in simulation. The first time I knew it was real was when he said kicking up some dust, because he had never said that before. Everything else I'd heard before, but kicking up some dust was brand new. And that was new to them. They didn't really know. Turned out to be a huge problem on the next landing, actually. So good.
So how difficult it is to get a judge of size of things.
Okay.
When they were saying that they're X thousand of feet above the surface, and you have no landmarks or nothing to compare size against, you have no idea if the crater that you're looking at is 1,000 feet across or if it's 10 feet across.
Okay, good. So it's a very hard human factors problem. Larry can talk about this a lot. For a couple reasons. I mean, if you see a tree, you know how big a tree is, or a truck. But also, just the pure vacuum of it, continually through the rest of the program, all the EVAs, they're constantly misjudging distances because they're used to looking through air at things that you know what they are, even if it's a tree in a place you've never been. What else?
rim alarm kept going off.
Okay.
Saying like 1202.
Okay.
And it's like kept recurring, but they kept saying they were good.
Okay, good. So program alarm, we'll talk a lot about that over the course of the semester. What's going on there? Why does it happen? First time it happens, I'm not sure if we heard it here. He said, we'll go on that alarm as long as it doesn't happen again. And it happens five more times. It's actually in this picture. It's right here on the computer. I don't know if you can see it at all. It says 1202 right there. There were 1201s and 1202s. That was the major technical anomaly during the landing. What else?
Near the end, Houston's calling for us down, and they're saying forward, forward, forward.
Yep. So Houston's calling, well, the thrust is under the computer control, actually, but they're constantly going forward. At one point, Aldrin says, you're pegged on horizontal velocity, okay? And that means there's a little, actually, it's these guys here. This is what they were calling a cross pointer, which is the output of the landing radar, although it's integrated with the inertial guidance, and it gives them the horizontal velocity. And at some point, the needles go off the scale, because he's going so fast across the surface. So when Aldrin says that, it's a little bit of a nerve-wracking thing. We have one more chair here for folks who are outside, and you're welcome to come in, sit on the floor if you want. You don't need to line up all there or wherever you like. Or maybe there's chairs in the hall you can grab too. What else? What is this we just looked at, actually? Anybody know?
Landing of 11.
It's the landing of Apollo 11, that's correct. What are you looking at when you looked at those images? Okay, it was just a simple 16-millimeter film camera hanging in front of the window on Aldrin's side. So we'll talk a bunch about this. The windows are triangular in the lunar module. And this is Armstrong's side. There's almost an exact mirror image on the other side. And all this is, you'll see it maybe even today, I think I have a picture. Just a straight 16-millimeter camera shooting from inside. Nothing fancy, no HD video all the way around the outside or anything like that. And the audio was separate, right? The audio was recorded. In fact, whoever this guy is the guy who just synced up the audio with that. And there's a lot more audio. We'll play that back later, too.
How indicative is this video of the actual field of view that Armstrong
would have? Pretty indicative, actually. So it's about what they could see. In fact, it's looking pretty close to even the angle that they would be looking out at. Any other observations? What are you listening to when we listen to this?
Question.
Yeah.
Is that static that's in the voice recording, or is that the actual sound of the thrusters firing from attitude?
That's a good question, actually. It does sound like it's the thrusters, but it's not. It's actually noise in the audio channel, which if I didn't start this really at the beginning. If I start at the beginning, the whole first 5 minutes are worrying about the comms channel and having intermittent comms. And Armstrong later said, you know, we simulated it with comms out, and we simulated it with full comm. We never simulated it with intermittent comm, and that was hugely distracting for him. But it does sound like that. It may be that the thrusters were affecting the electrical system, and that's what you're hearing. But you're not hearing the audio. There's no audio outside anyway. You may have gotten it through the frame, but that's not what it is. It's the disruption on the thrusters. You can actually see, if you look at the film carefully in some of the early parts, especially up here, because they're talking about it, you can see the servoing of the attitude control in the jiggering of the horizon there. And that's partly the limit cycle in the thrusters, and it's partly the thrusters responding to fuel slosh and trying to keep it level. What else? What are you hearing?
A lot of information flowing back and forth between the ground and the crew.
Okay.
Talking about fuel levels, altitude, speed.
Okay. Who's the crew? Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin. Who's on the ground? Anybody know? There's only one person talking. Who's the Capcom? Charlie Duke, who was then the lunar module pilot on Apollo 16 and an MIT graduate. Were you its advisor?
He was my first graduate student.
Yeah. Why does he say you got a bunch of guys about to turn blue? Because the fuel is running low. And you can hear at the end they're saying 60 seconds, 30 seconds, what is that? It's actually not how much fuel is left, but it's how much time before you have a mandatory abort based on minimum fuel. Anybody notice the beginning? It's an interesting piece. Right here.
I think it's here at 5. You said you're a go. You can't take it all at 4 minutes. Roger, you're a go. You go to continue power defense.
What's going on here?
Altitude 40,000.
In Eagle Houston, we got data dropout. You're still looking good.
Looks like they're flying away to away from the moon to me. What's happening there?
Pitch over. They were slowing down and now they're coming up to a more upright position.
Not quite. On Apollo 11, they start out and they're facing down because they didn't quite trust the landing radar. They wanted to see the ground. It was the only flight where they're actually essentially lying. See, they're lying on their stomachs going backwards, but able to look out the window. And then what happens is if they lie like that, they're turning over. They call it yaw around. And then they're lying on their backs looking up. And then pitch over is when the limb literally sort of stand itself up and then they look out. So they sort of start like this. They turn over, which is kind of scary because you're not seeing the thing you're landing on at all for a few seconds. And then they come up gradually and they look down. Every other flight, they started facing outward. But this one, and that was actually the source of some problems later too. Any other observations? What kind of a moment is this? Is it relaxed? Is it a crisis?
You ask anybody your parents' age where they were that night, and they'll tell you. It was a worldwide moment of tenseness, anxiety, and certainly pride. Not just in the United States, but generally worldwide.
So,
is this something that's a routine operation for them, or?
I mean, they did it in the simulator. He says it's better than the simulator. Something they've done 1,000 times in simulator, and when they're doing it, you can't really hear it so much from their voices. It's complete chaos. Everything's falling apart. For two reasons. First of all, is the program alarms we mentioned. And second is they're landing almost a mile long. And actually, maybe more than a mile long. I'm forgetting the exact number. And so by the time they get to the landing site, they have no idea where they are. And the idea is that when they pitch over, they look out and they see all these craters they recognize and they pick their spot perfectly. This time when they pitch over, totally disoriented, no idea where to go. And that's where that big crater is there. You can see it come through, and that's when he skips over. Armstrong later describes himself like a frog bouncing around looking for the right lily pad. And he says, I was absolutely adamant in my God-given right to be wishy-washy about where I put her down. So the guys on the ground are worried because he's running up against his maximum fuel. He actually was very aware of exactly how much fuel he had, but there was no reason to rush it and to get in sooner than he really had to. So amazing handling of a crisis by the whole group, actually. You can barely hear it in there, but it was definitely a crisis. This image, just to let you know, is actually made for me by a guy named John Knoll, who is the chief animator at Industrial Light and Magic, and did the animations for the Apollo 13 movie and for Avatar. If you watch, you know that movie Avatar? It's the first name that comes up after the movie ends is animation John Knoll. And this is a computer graphic image of what it would have looked like if you were Neil Armstrong at this moment about 300 feet above the moon when he reaches up and he turns off the automatic targeting and he flies it in a kind of semi-manual fly-by-wire mode to land. And we went through and we did a whole bunch of research and we got every switch and every meter and everything right. And we'll say more about this picture later, but includes not only the computer, which we'll talk a lot about, but even all the little pieces of paper checklist that they have taped all over the cockpit and whatnot, as well as what he can see out the window. And so if you were to look at the other side, I don't have an image of the other side, although there are photographs, you'd see that 16 millimeter movie camera sitting, just hanging right in front of the window on the other side. Okay, that's just a little kind of intro. Welcome to Engineering Apollo. I'm David Mindell. Larry Young, just out of curiosity, just for seating, how many of you are registered for the class, and how many of you are sure you're going to take it, and how many of you are unsure? Okay, just gives us some.
I've put in a request for a larger classroom. If we get any news before this class is over, I'll let you know. Otherwise, I hope we have everybody registered on Stellar. On that website, we'll announce any change in classroom. Last ditch is if there's a change in classroom, we'll just put a poster on this door.
Before we introduce ourselves, maybe I'll just say a little bit about the origins of this class. I was writing a book about the Apollo landing, really about the computers and the software, and thought about, you know, obviously, the thing you do at MIT when you're trying to learn something is teach a class about it. This was about 8 years ago, I think. And somebody said, oh, you should talk to Larry. So Larry and I got together one day, and we decided we would teach it together. This is the fourth time we've taught it, I think, every other year for 8 years. And it turned into a kind of an amazing experience for all of us for a bunch of different reasons, not least of which was that the Apollo astronauts who had graduated from MIT, which was, I think, between a third and a half of the ones who actually walked on the moon were MIT graduates, most of them had never been invited back to MIT to talk about their experience before. We invited them. In fact, the first year we had Charlie Duke here talking about both his experience as CAPCOM on Apollo 11 and his experience as Lunar Module Pilot on Apollo 16. And there's just this wealth of knowledge within the MIT community, broadly defined, that includes Draper Labs, it includes the alumni, includes the faculty here, about what happened on Apollo, that's worth communicating to the students. And, you know, it's more than a generation ago now. Some of those people aren't going to be around too much longer. Several of the people who have presented to the class have passed away, like Bob Siemens. Although hopefully we'll watch the video of his class presentation from about 5 years ago. So we wanted to take advantage of that community before some of the older members pass on. But at the same time, Apollo is really this story that, first of all, everybody thinks they know about it, but there's so much more to know than you learn on watching Nova or even the Apollo 13 movie. And second of all, it really is this kind of moment in engineering history that requires a fair amount of study and discussion to understand, A, what went on, B, what it can teach us about engineering in general, particularly the engineering and the politics of large, complicated projects, which there's quite a few of today. And so the general idea for the semester is to look at the Apollo program in detail in all of its different forms as an example, in many cases the best example of a large engineering project, but try to be agnostic about what scale we're looking at, from the level of, you know, Bill Widnall, who designed the digital autopilot for the command module. Don Isles, who was a 24-year-old BU graduate who wrote the code that you just saw executing for the landing, to Kennedy's decisions and the geopolitics of the Cold War, and to think about all those things on a continuum as part of the project. Each has political components, each has technical components. How do those things kind of interact? So we'll say a lot more of that as we come to it. Maybe just ask Larry to introduce yourself.
I'm Larry Young. I have to tell you, this is my favorite course. it's a privilege to teach with David. I think we bring complementary experiences. Dave is a well-known historian in the history of science. I've had some experience in man-machine systems and complex systems. A little bit about MIT and Apollo, some of which David has alluded to. First of all, personally, I'm the Apollo professor at MIT. How did that happen? It's because my friend and dear colleague Bob Siemens endowed a chair at MIT, and I was asked to become, thus far, the only Apollo program professor. And Bob wanted to recognize the importance of the Apollo experience and its relationship to education as well as research. Bob got his PhD from MIT in the same program that I did, the instrumentation program, was a member of the faculty in the Aeroastro department and later dean at MIT, as well as having a number of important Washington appointments. His relevance to the Apollo program is that he was the technical person who drove it at NASA. He was the general manager at NASA. He was telling Jim Webb how to go and approach the Kennedy administration about making this thing real and also setting the timeline for it. So that was one very important MIT tie to the Apollo program.
There's Bob Siemens with Wernher von Braun and President Kennedy touring around Cape Canaveral in 1963.
Right. We'll get back to some of Siemens' writings and his influence, which were extremely important. David also mentioned the immediate relevance of MIT in terms of our members of the Apollo flight crews. In addition to Charlie Duke, who we talked about, Buzz Aldrin was a graduate student with me. Ed Mitchell was a graduate student at the same time that I was. A man whose name you don't hear much is Phil Chapman, who was an Apollo astronaut, did not fly and left the program. And there's one more Dave Scott, of course.
Dave Scott.
And Dave Scott. So strong MIT influence in the piloting business. On it. And then, of course, the MIT Instrumentation Laboratory, which now the Draper Laboratory, at that time was completely within MIT, run by the amazing man, Stark Draper, head of the Instrumentation Laboratory, and at the same time the head of the MIT Aeroastro Department, a space buff, and he had his ideas about the roles of automation and computers in flight control that we will hear about more. So there was a lot of MIT involvement in Apollo from the very, very beginning. I wanted to say a few things about that I want you to be thinking about the remainder of the semester that go beyond the technical issues and the management issues that Dave and I will bring out and that come out in the reading. Apollo was about more than landing on the moon. It was about much more than landing on the moon. Okay, and if you ask man in the street, what are the iconic photographs of the 20th century? You come back to the same photos all the time. The footsteps on the moon, first footsteps on the moon. The fact that it was done and it was accomplished was a tribute to the success of a very, very complex system. And it introduced systems engineering in a way that had never been done before. And we'll get to that concept as well. The picture of the Earth from space, of the lonely blue planet, and then the accompanying picture of Earthrise that you're all familiar with, the Earth rising over the moon, really can be said to give birth to the Green Movement. It got people thinking about the environmental problems on the Earth in a way that had never been accomplished by the evidence, although it should have been there, the evidence that had been discussed before, and the whole Earth movement, ecological thrust of future programs was very important and certainly an outgrowth of it. The digital age, was just coming in, and you'll hear a lot more about this from Dave, and we'll read about it in his book. But this was the first time that real-time digital autopilots, or real-time digital control, was used. And, you know, and imagine the risk amazing accomplishments of our colleagues in getting these tiny to laughably small computers in terms of memory to go and accomplish the jobs that they did. And when you hear about 1202 alarm, you start to understand what lay behind it. You will, I think, be filled with admiration for the cleverness and the agility that went with these early digital computers. And then finally, and this is something which was notable in the United States, in which we were going through a rough period. 1969 was the end of a very sad decade of uplifting, of a sort of a we did it. We was whether or not you were working on Apollo, and I had a tiny part in it, but we all felt that we were part of this. It represented a broader sense of technical optimism, in my opinion, that said, if there is a project of sufficient importance that a group, in this case the country, was willing to put the resources into it, it could be accomplished. And I mean, the idea of the audacity of saying, "We'll go to the moon and come back successfully within the decade," starting from where we were when Kennedy made his announcement at Rice, that is amazing, and it brought forward a can-do attitude. Also accompanied by a relatively enormous expenditure of public funds. We haven't been repeated since then. So keep in mind some of those aspects in addition to the technical and scientific aspects of the course. And have a good time.
Do you want to say a little bit about your research and the MBL and all that?
Okay, a little bit about myself. I come from I was one of Draper's boys. I came from a background in control systems and application of control systems to try to make mathematical models of the human as a pilot, as a decision maker, as an astronaut. I worked with Draper a little bit on the question of what roles are most appropriately done by machines and which ones are done by humans. And with Professor Yao-Tzu Li, we established the Manned Vehicle Laboratory, which just finished celebrating its 50th year. And in there, we dealt largely with looking at human operations, human operations in an aerospace environment, trying to model the physiological systems so that we could treat the human component as yet one more black box. My own interest was in the inner ear. Others have been interested in posture control, respiration, spacesuits, and so forth. I had lucky enough to have flown a lot of space experiments and was a backup astronaut in the shuttle era. So I'm a space cadet.
I'm David Mindell. I'm half a professor here in the history of technology and half in aeroastro. My background in engineering is as an electrical engineer making control systems. A lot of it in the deep undersea realm. I work for the group that found the Titanic for about 15 years, exploring shipwrecks on the deepest parts of the ocean, building control systems and navigation systems for underwater robots, Jason, if you're familiar with those, and some of the early autonomous vehicles, still have a big hand in the undersea world. Although unbeknownst to me when I worked down there, I was working for a guy who was a student of Tom Sheridan, who was a professor up here, who did a lot of the early work in supervisory control and humans and automation. And when I came to MIT as a grad student, got interested in the history of a lot of those issues, written a bunch of books on way back to the American Civil War, Second World War, and the early history of feedback control and computers, and then the book that you'll read parts of, maybe all of it for the class on the Apollo program and the computers and control systems associated with Apollo. So Larry and I share an interest in human-machine relationships and different issues around that part of it, and the course is definitely skewed that way. We'll spend more time talking about the computers and the control systems than we will talking about the Saturn engines, although that's good stuff for you guys to explore as part of your projects as well. But we will talk about propulsion and other aspects. But given that we're at MIT and we have these resources to draw on, we'll tend to emphasize the human part of it. And again, this course is a course about Apollo as a complex system. And even that idea can be broken down a little bit. So there's the actual systems, the lunar modules, the rockets, the whole thing that they interact together, sort of the engineering artifacts of it as they operated on the mission. That's one way to think about the system. But there's also this enormous system to generate those technologies, all the people on the ground, the different contractors, the different pieces, and the socio-political technical system that put the funding in place, that put the president's goal on his desk at the right moment. It was really Bob Siemens was there at those moments, and we'll watch the video of him tell that story. And you know, why did the nation decide, or why does any nation think that somehow accomplishing this rather esoteric engineering feat is indicative of national strength, which was the assumption behind Apollo? If we can go to the moon and put a man on the moon, and you heard this all the time in the years after, why can't we do X, like solve poverty or, you know, fight climate change is the modern version of it. The ironic part about that, of course, is we have since learned that accomplishments in human spaceflight are not representative of national strength, because the Soviets did very well in human spaceflight while their own system was crumbling from within. And yet there are still many Americans and many nations around the Earth who believe that. And in some sense, as we talk about current day U.S. space policy, the U.S. is a little bit of a victim of that idea, I think, an idea that we created, that a lot of the rest of the world has bought, and now we're unable to create a space policy that really works within that framework. You know, how do we think about Apollo now 40 plus years later? One of the things that interests me about it as a historian is the story of technology is usually told as higher, faster, further. Certainly was in the 20th century. In fact, those three things, higher, faster, further, pretty much characterizes aviation. You know, you got to remember that Charles Lindbergh watched the Apollo 8 launch. Orville Wright was still alive at the time. Is that right? I think he died after. So if you were born in the early, mid-20th century, you saw an awful lot of change just in 30 years. Whereas many of you may well have flown to Boston for this semester on a 737 that was designed in 1960. What does that tell you about how technology evolves? The highest, the furthest, the farthest a human being has ever gone happened 1969 to 1972. Never been higher, faster, or further so far. In an interview on the 30th anniversary, they asked Buzz Aldrin, so, you know, what surprises you most looking back? And he said, you got to remember, you know, we thought this was important because we were just the first of the entire planet going off to the moon and elsewhere. We never imagined that there'd only be 12 people who walked on the moon 30, 40 years later. And there are still people who say progress in technology stopped in 1969. When I know most people don't really believe that today, there's been a lot of progress in technology, but it's been a different kind of progress. And I do think a lot changed around 1969, 1970. It's interesting, if you look just in those 2 years or so, 3 years, within 3 years of Apollo 11, which is July 20th, 1969, the supersonic transport, SST, was canceled. The Apollo program was canceled. You know, don't forget, there were two more missions and many more plans that never happened with Apollo, shut right down. The Environmental Protection Agency was founded in April of 1971. The first Earth Day was within a month of that. And the microprocessor was invented in 1970. And a whole set of things that sort of indicate you know, the world was going to continue to change, but it was going to change in different ways. And again, that's what's interesting about Apollo. On the one hand, it's an old-fashioned higher, faster, further project. And on the other hand, it's got this core in it of, you know, cyber, networked, real-time, interactive, digital that is so characteristic of the world we live in today. How do we think about that 40 years later? What does it tell us about how technology unfolds in surprising ways? And again, what was unusual about it? It really was a strange project. It's really a very hard thing to reproduce. You constantly hear, we need an Apollo project for energy. We need an Apollo project for climate change. We need an Apollo project for this or for that. Very, very hard to do. Not least because actually the problem of going to the moon, as difficult it was extremely focused problem, right? No question when you got there and did it at this moment. What are the criteria for success? You know, it's in the president's statement, you know, send a man to the moon and return him safely to Earth. Interestingly, says nothing about whether the guy is going to be flying the vehicle or not. Very clear what happened. Whereas these other more complicated problems, very difficult to set up metrics for success, very different idea of what would be successful, very much more complicated projects. Whereas, you know, the Apollo project was sort of purely Newtonian in some way, right? When you worked out all the dynamics and you basically were going to get there. What do we learn about engineering and how engineering works? That's why the course is called Engineering Apollo. I think, how many of you have been out in the world working on engineering projects? So a good number of people. That's typical for graduate students. I used to teach a lot of courses to MIT seniors, and they would go out for their first summer, often on in a company or something, come back and go, "Wow, who knew it was so complicated?" Because it doesn't look as simple as it does on the textbooks and on the blackboards around here. And part of this class is an attempt to try to harness some of that complexity and understand with some frameworks about how engineering knowledge is created, how it's deployed, what the compromises are. That's definitely the story of the Apollo computer. You start out with a bunch of academics who say, "Oh yeah, we can get guidance to the moon, no problem. It's this beautiful, elegant problem. We'll put, you know, four gimbals in the spacecraft," and then lo and behold, it's too heavy to put four gimbals. I can only put three gimbals in the spacecraft. And under extreme electrical power constraints and other types of constraints, a lot of compromising going on, a lot of table banging, a lot of rough times for people, and the success was definitely built on the backs of some broken lives, a lot of broken families, a lot of very heavy focus for people, and we'll hear about that from some of them. I'll just go through a few images, talk about some of these themes. You know, Larry speaks with some authority. His wife is one of the preeminent historians of photography working today. And the 20th century was really the century of photography. Images really became dominant and really began to capture what people thought about the world. And in any survey of those images, this comes out as one of the most notable images of the 20th century. So that's beyond engineering, that's beyond MIT, but just in the broader cultural landscape of what is people's consciousness. This image, Larry also mentioned the Earthrise images, changed people's minds, changed people's consciousness, changed what it meant to be human. Anybody know who this is? It's Buzz Aldrin, right? It's actually very interesting to me. There's almost no images of Neil Armstrong on the moon. And he's sort of this absence at the center of this project, which is a little bit in keeping with his personality. You can see him there, actually, taking the picture. And there's a lot of speculation about whether that was intentional on Buzz's part because he was hurt that he wasn't the first man on the moon, which is ironic because the picture that everybody knows, and I'll come back to this picture, is of Buzz Aldrin. It's of the second man on the moon. Happily, the MIT PhD. There's the Earthrise image. Again, the environmentalism had been around for a very long time, but the modern environmental movement, the origins of it really are pegged to around 1970, 1971, and this sort of sense of the Earth as a whole globe, you know, the Whole Earth Catalog, anybody ever heard of that catalog? Came out right about this period. People really began thinking about the Earth as a unit as opposed to separate political or geographic divisions. international competition. You know, the whole thing, again, part of the system is the Soviet Union. And Apollo would not have happened the way it did at all, probably at all, without the perceived Soviet competition. And if you look inside, as we will, the conversations between Kennedy and Robert McNamara, who was the Secretary of Defense, and Bob Siemens, and Hugh Dryden, who was the head of NASA at the time, they really conceived the project as there's this person called Third World Man, that's how they refer to him, sitting in some non-aligned country in Africa or particularly in India, and they'd be watching the moon race. And whether they became communist or capitalist would be dependent on who got to the moon first. That's pretty much the principle behind the Apollo program, okay? Now, whether those people ever existed or whether we're going to make a decision like that based on this or not, unclear, but it's certainly true that landing on the moon and a lot of the other human spaceflight had a lot of impact globally that mattered in the context of the Cold War. You know, the question that Kennedy asks is, What space program would provide dramatic results that we could win? That's the quote. Dramatic results that we could win. Not science, not technological evolution, not engineering capacity. Dramatic results that we can win. That was the question. We talked a little bit about this part already. Presidential leadership, there's a whole angle to the program that we'll talk about. And it's not just Kennedy, it's Johnson. There's an argument that if Kennedy wasn't assassinated, the program would never have survived, but it became a kind of monument to Kennedy. And then Nixon kills the program and creates the space shuttle program. And there's a very good argument to be made that a lot of the problems that the space shuttle program had, sort of socio-technically over the years, can be rooted in its origins as this kind of secondary follow-on to Apollo. And by the way, the shuttle was conceived by all the same people who conceived Apollo. And so why did they think of something that was so far-reaching the first time around, and the second time around something that was in low Earth orbit that had these complex issues around safety and experimental operation?
Your use of the word kills the program implies, you know, that it was the wrong decision. And there's a good argument that it was the correct decision.
Yeah, that fair enough. In fact, we'll talk about this. You know, you may have heard this, and it's true, that if you go down to the Kennedy Space Center in Florida, anybody seen the Saturn V down there? And the other ones sitting in Houston at the Johnson Space Center may be about to be brought inside, or is it in a shed already? Yeah, it's a shed already. You know, those were not mock-ups. Those are real Saturn V's that were built, that were intended to be flown, that were left over at the end. And there were at least two more flights, and then there's a whole series of studies and follow-ons. But there is a case to be made that actually the focus on the end of the decade goal, and we'll see this how it happened step by step, pushed the engineers to focus on a system that was very much single use, that didn't have as much broad applicability. I mean, the opposite end of the shuttle, in a way. The shuttle was this really space truck, was the phrase that was always used for it. Very general purpose, really just designed to get you and the stuff there and then do a whole lot of different things. Whereas Apollo was focused to land a man on the moon and bring him home by the end of the decade. And that achieving that goal may have compromised a longer-term vision for spaceflight. This is, again, a lot of that political leadership being briefed in the launching room for the Saturn rocket. Now, I'm pretty sure this picture is taken, and this is one of the great stories that Siemens told about how he was sent down to the Cape on a Sunday because the president was in Florida, and at the last minute they got this call. They wanted to have it. He wanted a tour of the place, and Siemens' boss was unavailable. So Siemens went down there. The president came on Sunday morning. He toured him around all day, one-on-one, had this whole sort of personal experience with him flying around, and that was on Sunday. And from there, Kennedy flew to Dallas, and Friday he was shot. So I believe this picture is taken on that trip in November of 1963. You can see the periscopes for watching the launches from the blockhouse. A lot of background in aviation. See Charles Lindbergh and the sort of great tradition there. embarrassed to say I don't know who this is. Forgetting from the last time we taught it. But Lindbergh, you know, was very much around. Lindbergh died in 72, I believe, or maybe even a little later. And, you know, people ask a lot of questions, especially about Neil Armstrong and why he was so much not a public figure after his landing on the moon. And there's a good story in Jim Hansen's biography about Lindbergh got to know him in the context of the Apollo 8 launch, and then they became closer touch when it became clear that Armstrong, I mean, everyone knew that whoever landed on the moon first was going to be kind of stature to Lindbergh, and Lindbergh said, don't make the mistakes that I made once I became a public figure. You're not going to win at that game, and that Armstrong made a conscious choice not to be so much of a public figure. Obviously, it's a great story about technology. Where did all the pieces come from? Who designed them? How were they all integrated? In fact, I really learned this from a paper that a bunch of students wrote the first time we taught the course, how much the Saturn was really just a straight extension of the V2. That so many of the basic design was sort of foreseen by the V2, and it was all the same people from the Nazi rocket program who had come over to Huntsville with von Braun, and it was just a kind of scaled up version. And then you have the command module and the service module. You're familiar with the issues there on Apollo 13, probably. We'll talk about them. Who were these companies? Why were they selected? Where were they from? What was their background? I'll show you a slide about that in a minute. But again, you know, this is one of the iconic images, of course, of the Saturn V, but every one of these pieces is built by a different group in a different place. So literally in the image of the rocket, you have a kind of coming together of the country, and that was a big part of the challenge of the program, but necessary for a lot of different reasons.
Point out mm-hmm. that we have the emergency return rocket on the very top.
Mm-hmm.
Great concern, you know, this was early in human spaceflight activities. Great concern about what will happen if there's an explosion on the launch pad and the ability to just take the command and service module out and bring it back. An idea which was dropped, unfortunately, in the shuttle development.
Mm-hmm. And actually, raise another, a real theme that'll run through the term is risk. What kinds of risks are acceptable, both program risks and also risks to the astronauts? There's a lot of things that when you look at these landings, you just go, oh my God, that would never be acceptable today. Like if an astronaut fell and broke his leg and couldn't climb the ladder, he was going to be dead. And a few of those kind of killer criticalities that they just decided they couldn't deal with any other way, and that was how it was going to be. And yet, you know, the program was still accomplished, and that's one of the things I think should be part of a current discussion about space policy is not how do we keep the risk as low as possible, but what sort of risks are acceptable to the public and to the people who are involved. Another image of the command module up there. This is one of my favorite pictures of the whole program, and it's an image from the MIT Instrumentation Laboratory, which is now known as the Draper Lab, and we'll talk a little bit about why it's not part of MIT anymore, but it was at the time, from April of 1963, and it's intended to illustrate the differing effects of automation in the command module. So full automation, the only control that's there is the abort button. And the astronauts are sort of sleeping and smoking cigars and playing cards and basically generally bored. Whereas no automation, and they're constantly busy and they're doing all these different things and very high chance of error. You know, not a bad spectrum for how we think about human systems today, actually. And the idea was that what they ended up with had to be somewhere in between these two extremes that was actually usable and doable. You know, early on when the astronauts learned there was going to be a digital computer in the cockpit, they said, okay, well, we'll just have to approve every instruction that the computer executes, Well, and they said, well, you know, it's 200,000 instructions per second, which is ridiculously slow for a digital computer today, but probably more. But at the end of the day, before the computer ever could fire any engine, the pilot had to click approve. Again, this is sort of the answer to that problem. One of the, there's many of these images, but how the human is integrated into the system, what are the jobs they're actually going to do? What did it mean to fly, quote unquote, to the moon? You know, the project began where Neil Armstrong, he published papers saying, you know, we should be allowed to fly the Saturn V off the launch pad by hand. In fact, I think, Larry, you even worked on that control system a little bit.
Thank goodness it never got up
with it. Yeah. And Wernher von Braun said, don't even think about it. And to this day, no one has flown a, no American, I'm not so sure about Soviets, but no American has ever flown a.
Now at the other end, at the landing on the moon, John Young said, no way, I'm going to go all that distance and let some black box land me on the moon.
Right. And Dave Scott said that too. And we'll talk to him. So you'll learn all about what these various components are in detail. I like this image because it communicates the way that the human is sort of integrated into the machine. Reaches way out into manufacturing. This is actually the manufacturing of the software for the Apollo computer. It was literally woven by textile workers in old New England textile plants, now converted to electronics plants. You can see she's got a knife here. A needle, and she's weaving the wires in and out of these little magnetic cores to program the software with the aid of some paper tape controlled, numerically controlled production machinery. Great part of the story. We'll talk a lot about the landing. That's why I opened with it. Armstrong said, on a scale of difficulty of 1 to 10, walking around on the moon was about a 3. Landing on the moon was a 13. That's why I played you that piece to open up with. The actual landing from what they call PDI, Powered Descent Initiation, which is at this point you're still in orbit. And orbit, for all its hazards, is a pretty safe place to be once you're stabilized and you know what you're doing. Whereas once you fire that rocket, you're either going to crash, you're going to land, or you're going to abort sometime in the next 10 minutes or so. And 10 minutes is actually the longest string of continuous operations in the entire mission. All the other critical things were less time than that. Plus, you're the furthest from home. Plus, you're intentionally aiming to bump into a rocky thing, hopefully to do it in a smart way. And how they did that and how they broke it down is instructive. In fact, I'm actually working on an automated helicopter project to figure out how to do automated full-size helicopter landings, and we're breaking it down in a very similar set of phases to this. This one is, again, this is just another way to look at that system, and a very important way to look at that system. All the different places that were there. Some of these are places that are still around, that are still very much part of aerospace and human spaceflight. Obviously, the spaceflight centers. Others are companies that are either long gone or long incorporated into other things. Anybody know what International Latex made? The suits and the gloves. Fairly good concentration, mostly around the computer stuff and electronics in New England. Anybody know what Link made? Binghamton, New York. Simulators. Huge part of this program. In fact, somebody ought to write a book just on the history of the Apollo simulators. It was really the first project where the flights, the systems, were all simulated in great detail ahead of time. Gave a huge boost to the whole technology of simulation. Whole bunch of these other companies, and in every case, it matters where they are. It matters what they built before. North American Aviation, who built the command module, had never built a spacecraft before, right? Mercury and Gemini, anybody know who built the capsules for that? McDonnell Douglas in St. Louis. So they go to the third one and they choose a different contractor altogether, kind of a gutsy move. What had North American built before, in addition to the P-51 Mustang? The X-15. And so, but a lot of issues around that. Grumman, anybody know what Grumman did? Lunar module. Anybody know why they were picked? What did they build before? And after, actually. They mostly built Navy fighter planes. So why did they pick them for the lunar module? They were good at heavy landing gear. And most of the lunar module is landing gear. Over-designed, it turned out, but nobody knew that.
So they have Thiokol, go back one. Look, how do they place Thiokol in Ohio?
That's a good question.
No, it's Veronica is in Ohio.
Thiokol, it's like Pennsylvania.
Yeah,
now they're in Utah.
It's not Utah.
Yeah, I don't know what the origin of that was. But this is as much the system as the rocket itself, right? And every piece, and that's what this shows, every piece of, and this is only a brief part of the rocket, and look how many contractors there are, all from different parts of the country. And again, this was not a time when it was that easy to hop on a jet airliner and fly like we do today, for go out to LA for a night and come back. It was a lot more exotic, and certainly not where you had email or other, that kind of stuff. And all the different companies, I think these are mostly the same as the previous one. And what's interesting about this image, actually, this is a sort of later one, because of these contractors, there's only one university, MIT. And actually, an earlier one would have them as prime. Here it has them associate prime for the guidance system. Very unusual, controversial choice to choose a university to build a core piece of operational hardware. In fact, there were protests to Congress from inertial guidance companies about that. Anybody know, want to take a guess maybe why that was done? There's a bunch of different reasons. Sorry?
Relationship between Webb and Draper.
There was a relationship between Webb and Draper. Siemens had been a Draper student. And Siemens pretty much says, you know, the president was from Massachusetts. We thought it was important to have some contracts up there.
On the right side, we have ABCO developing heat shield. The heat shield was one of the big unknowns at that time. Yeah, we've gotten mercy about it, but this Apollo was much larger, much heavier, and was coming back at the velocities that are consistent with the cislunar orbit.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't know, it wasn't clear how to do that. The Russians were struggling with it and had not succeeded in successfully getting a reentry vehicle back into the late 50s. So ABCO was a high technology local company, which had its very important component.
And very much a, it's not over till it's over, especially on Apollo 11. They landed, you know, till you get home, you haven't won the game. Although it's interesting, if you look at the early conversations between Webb and Siemens and Kennedy, there's this idea that the Soviets might put a man on the moon, but they're not going to care about getting them home. And what makes us American is we actually pay attention to the return to Earth, which is a ridiculous characterization of the Soviets at the time. But there was that sort of idea. Any one of these things can cause a problem. How do you put them all together? Larry mentioned systems engineering was a relatively new thing, relatively exotic idea, and very complicated, and a lot of people resisted it. I think Chris Kraft said recently he was the sort of pioneering flight director and then head of the Johnson Space Center. So that it brought all that stuff in. I thought it was a huge layer of bureaucracy. It was going to make everything too expensive and too complicated, and I was right. So we'll talk a little bit about the competing program that the Soviets had. I think, Larry, weren't you one of the first Westerners to ever see this piece? This
yes, that was
piece?
My 15 seconds of fame, as Ed Crawley and I had our pictures on the front page of the New York Times standing in front of this when it was first revealed, and it wasn't publicly revealed until 1989.
At the fall of the Soviet Union. We'll talk a lot about some of the critical decisions. Here's three of them. the Lunar Orbit Rendezvous, LOR, decision, justifiably one of the best studied large-scale engineering decisions of the program. Why did you choose this particular architecture? Some interesting reasons for that. Actually, I think it was the first time we taught the course. There was a student, Ben Koo, who was doing his ESD PhD on systems architecture, and he created a new kind of object-oriented program that would run through a bunch of architectures, and this was the one he chose as his test case. The whole idea of all-up testing, that you needed to test the system as a whole rather than just relying on the entire each component one at a time. The idea of sending Apollo 8 to lunar orbit in 1968 when the lunar module wasn't quite ready yet, another very, very big one. And for a lot of people, including a lot of people at MIT, Apollo 8 was as big a deal as Apollo 11. That's when they really felt like the program had really proved itself. And there was no landing on Apollo 8, but it was a successful circumnavigation of the moon. The background. At least three key groups. In some ways, the best known of them are the first one, or the first two even. Von Braun's rocket team from Peenemünde, you've all heard of that story. But then also the Space Task Group is a very interesting story. Basically coming out of NASA Langley, which is a famous, mostly aeronautics and flight test center down in Virginia, still there today. A lot of the junior engineers in that group were MIT grads and Draper grads. And that group spawned the high-speed flight station out at Edwards Air Force Base, which became NASA Dryden today. And then pretty much moved to form the Johnson Space Center with Bob Gilruth as its main as the head. Very interesting to me, because someone interested in the history of human factors and history of flight controls, Gilruth had done pioneering work in flying qualities, and there's still people today who do flying qualities work on aircraft. Gilruth was the pioneer in that, and so the whole Space Task Group has this sort of origin in the whole idea of what is the pilot doing, what level of control, what kind of systems do you need to build for that. But then also there's this whole other group. These are people from the West Coast, particularly out of companies like TRW, who had developed systems engineering during the 50s for particularly the Atlas ICBM program. Very different approach to it, not used to flying people in airplanes, much more mathematical, much more focused on computers, much more abstract. And it's really these three groups, these guys build the rocket, these guys build the spacecraft, and these guys tie it all together, that make up the Apollo program. And huge conflicts in bringing those three groups together, and the different ways of doing things. And to some degree, what you see as the Apollo system is the resolving of what those conflicts are. And some of the accidents.
That there were similar kinds of conflicts going on in the Soviet Union between the rocket people, their ICBM people, and the payloads. Mm-hmm. And basically, the military running the rocket program couldn't care less about putting something in orbit. Didn't understand the political implications of it. It had to be sold on the military applications of reconnaissance satellites and so forth. Mm-hmm. There was a similar, a very parallel kind of division.
Yep. I mean, interestingly, there's a case to be made that the U.S. lunar program succeeded because it was more tightly run and more centralized, and that the systems engineers were successful in beating all the other groups into submission and creating the group as hierarchically centrally controlled. The Soviet one was run much more as competing fiefdoms and sort of more organically, if you will, and that was one of the sources for its failure, which is exactly the opposite of what your stereotype about why the capitalist side would win. And the fact that the American lunar program was demonstrating the superiority of the American system was as much due to, you know, rigidly hierarchical control as it was due to openness and democracy. And then, you know, one of my students pointed out to me a long time ago, you can barely go a week in this culture. You might try this experiment. You probably won't succeed it if you're taking a class. But at It's going a week without a single reference to the Apollo program in popular culture. It's amazing how much is out there. You know, I noticed there was a kind of designer jeans called For All Mankind, where it's like written on the rear end of the jeans, it says For All Mankind, which is the slogan of. And this is also one of my favorite ones, which is that MTV has, anybody seen that image on MTV? If you win the MTV Music Award, it's actually a little statue. It's not an Oscar, it's a statue of Buzz Aldrin standing next to this flag. And they went on first on the air, I think it was like, you know, New Year's Day 1981, and they turned on the switch at midnight of that day. And the first image they put up there was Aldrin on the moon. Why? Because they were running on a really low budget. It was a public domain image. They didn't have to pay anything to license it. And then from there on, Aldrin on the Moon has become the sort of icon of MTV, which is sort of weird, right? Because MTV is supposedly this kind of modern, cutting-edge thing. Maybe I'm dating myself. It was when I was in high school in the 80s. Still to this day, you see that imagery. But it's just interesting to look, either in conversations or in other sorts of references, how often you see references to the Apollo project. And, you know, as the astronauts are getting older, they're passing away, one a year or so. Armstrong obviously passed away just about 6 months ago. You hear this. And that's one of the interesting things about teaching a course like this, which is not what happened, right? It's about how Apollo, the meaning of it, changes a lot quicker than you'd expect. In fact, we first conceived the course, it must have been sometime during 2003, I think. And then at the end of 2003 or the beginning of 2004, and we were going to teach this course, and it was sort of like, you know, mostly historical, kind of looking at the end of 2004, George W. Bush announces the U.S. is going back to the moon. And a bunch of contracts are let to MIT to study lunar mission architectures. Gee, suddenly this course has a different kind of relevance. And the first time we taught it, it was in parallel with those studies that a lot of the students in the class were taking part in. That was true again in 05. By the time last couple times goes around, the Constellation program that sort of spawned had been canceled. Now we're maybe not going to the moon, but there's a Google Lunar X Prize, and there's Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, and you know, the in each of those sort of scenarios, the Apollo program has a different meaning.
If we're not going to the moon now, we're the only spacefaring nation that isn't.
So the Chinese say they're going. Russians are going. Those plans change several times, usually, between each iteration of when we teach the course. Very much influenced by this kind of imagery in their own way. So there's also the story about the news media. It was a huge popular culture event. Again, we're fortunate to have a colleague, Victor McElhaney, who reported on every single one of the Apollo events firsthand. And we'll come talk about what it was like to cover it. National pride, obviously. This is one of Al Bean's paintings. And again, as much a source of the origin for the project as anything. International relations, we'll talk a little bit about that. One of my students is writing a dissertation on how the moon program was sort of deployed by diplomats in a very concrete way in the years after the Apollo landings. So what are we doing here? What we're not doing is nostalgia for the old days of engineering and the good old days. And there's a lot of books that do this, say, boy, back then NASA could get things done and now it's all screwed up. That's not the theme of the course. We're not looking backward to wish it was like that again. It's not going to be like that again, and it shouldn't be like that again for any number of reasons. But it'll be something, and it'll be different the next time around. And we want to learn as much as we can about what went on from before and try not to relearn any of the hard lessons. It is a detailed understanding of the complex system development and its operations, looking technically and policy-wise at the key decisions. We'll teach you how to read some of the original engineering documents, how to understand sources, how to be critical of the way that the sources that you read. We will talk, and I'll say this when we go through the syllabus with participants, many of them very important participants, all of them actually, and look at the systems engineering and relevant to present day process. How do you look at an engineering project in its overall view? There's a variety of ways to talk about that. You know, my colleagues teach systems management and other aspects of systems engineering. This is, in a sense, a whole semester as a case study. Let's pick one project and just see how it went in every detail. And then a critical evaluation of the success. Was Apollo successful? In what ways was it? Maybe in what ways wasn't? What made it successful? What made people think it was successful? And understand how to think that through. Questions, comments on any of this? I'll hand out the syllabus in a minute, but before I do, I want to kind of list our guests, because one thing I'd like to do for the assignments is for people to take on just a few people each time to think about coming up with some questions for our guests. Some of these visits work best when we do them in a kind of interview format, rather than asking people to give you an hour-long lecture about what they did. To just have a question conversation format works really well. February 26, John Tilko will give a lecture about the Kennedy decision. He actually taught the course the last time around when I was on leave. He's a vice president at Aurora Flight Sciences and didn't have a lot of, had no involvement with Apollo other than being a kid who was heavily influenced by it. But then we'll get into this I just learned about last night, and it's really a treat. Farouk Elbaz, who was the head geologist for the Apollo program. I think he couldn't have been more than in his early 30s at the time. He's now a very senior professor at BU. And we've had a student interview him for the class, but we've never had him into class before. So he'll talk a lot about training the astronauts in geology, the site selection, and who knows what else. I haven't heard from him before. Bill Widnall, husband of our faculty colleague Sheila Widnall, spent his career at Draper Labs and designed the digital autopilot for the command module. Has a great lecture on that. Dave Scott and Jim Head. Dave Scott, as Larry mentioned, MIT PhD, commander of Apollo 15, flew on Gemini 8 with Neil Armstrong, which is a really interesting flight because they had an emergency and they had to abort. And Jim Head actually was also a geologist on the flight. He's now a professor at Brown and trained Dave in geology, and they had a really thrilling flight from the point of view of lunar geology. They've remained friends these entire 43 years since then, and we've had Dave before. We've never had the two of them together, so it's going to be really cool. I mentioned Victor McElhaney, who was the reporter for the Boston Globe for all of the flights during the 60s and interviewed most of the astronauts at the time. And you know, he'll tell you when the Apollo 11 astronauts were walking out of the building into the vehicle to get into the spacecraft. He was standing there right next to Norman Mailer watching them walk out, and a lot of perspective on what it was like to cover it. Don Iles graduated from BU with a degree in mathematics in 1967. So, you know, already to the point where, you know, you're 2 years away from the landing, got a job at Draper, and they said, hey, you know, we need somebody to write the code for the landing. Why don't you do it? And he wrote the code for the landing, was a key figure in figuring out that program alarm. Was a key figure in another emergency that happened on, almost caused an abort on Apollo 14. Apollo 13 they were all very involved in. Did a whole bunch of other stuff as well. Really interesting. Unlike most of the other people were pretty senior during the 60s, Don was a kid, you know. And so, as he'll tell you, you know, some people say I missed the 60s because of the Apollo program. I didn't miss the 60s. Running out at Draper during lunch, go to protest the Vietnam War, going back into Maria Zuber, who is our colleague, vice president of research. And I invited her because she recently ran this GRAIL mission, which is two spacecraft that kind of chase each other around the moon to map the gravity field of the moon. And That's really fresh, really exciting work. I haven't really heard her speak about it since the mission flew, and it's a nice example of what's going on in lunar science and technology today. Charlie Duke we will not have. I just learned that last night after I made this slide. But we are working on a couple of the other Apollo guys who may come in. And then one day we'll go visit the MIT Museum, who has some of the artifacts, and really see some of the stuff with Debbie Douglas. So it's a really good list, pretty typical list we've had. See, we've had Ed Mitchell, we've had Charlie Duke, we've had Buzz Aldrin, we've had Dave Scott, we've had a couple of the other Apollo, your colleague from Amherst, your friend Bob Parker, just a little bit on the final project. I don't want to say too much about it yet, but just some examples of some of the stuff that the students have written in papers. We haven't really decided how we're going to specify it, whether we'll focus on a landing, but there is a final project for the course that's a group course. And more or less the theme is, design a future lunar mission, learning with the lessons learned from Apollo with today's technology in one form or another. All right, I think that gets us to the most of this we've been through. Okay, so that gets us to the syllabus. One thing I want to say, just to finish up on this, one thing the course really isn't, there's a very rough sense of chronological order in the lectures, but it's not based on suspense. That's why I started with Apollo 11. You all know that it landed successfully. We're going to take the project as a whole, and I'm not going to gradually reveal pieces of it to you. We'll look at certain parts of it in greater detail, but we want to start with the entire scope and think about it as the entire scope all at once. And that said, I am going to want you to know a bunch of those details, and I'll show you how. So of the course readings, there's a few books that are required that are both on reserve and at the COOP. And then a lot of the reading is on Stellar in just PDF form. There is a lot of reading with this course. You need to do all of it. And there will be quizzes on the reading in class, most of them unscheduled. So the quizzes are designed basically that you get 100 if you've read the material and a 0 if you haven't. So they're not like super tricky sort of things. They're like if you got the scope of it at all, I should be able to do fine on the quizzes. But I'm going to assume that you've read the material before the lecture. We can talk about it in class for sure. If you have questions, that's great. But we got to get through it. I also always got to say to MIT, attendance in class is required. It's part of the course. There are going to be things that happen in class that you're going to be accountable for. If you miss a class, find a friend and get the notes. It does say that on the syllabus. Down to the bottom of the first page, half the course is, half the grade is in the final project. 25% is in those in-class quizzes. 10% is in class presence and participation. And part of that piece is, as I said, just wanting a few people each time we have a guest to do some a little bit of extra background reading and come up with some interesting questions for some of the guests. One of the great things about this class, by the way, so Dave Scott is not a public figure. He doesn't do Dancing with the Stars and all that stuff. He does two speeches a year. One is our class and one is an elementary school down with Jim Head and Brown. And a lot of them speak to public audiences a lot, but they never speak to MIT engineering students. And so they're thrilled to be able to come here and talk about the project in the terms that they understood it, and not to have to sort of gloss it for a neophyte audience. And so they really like sitting here talking about how the guidance worked, talking about what went right or what went wrong on their missions, about how they interacted with someone. That's one of the reasons we're able to get them here.
They all speak very warmly of the experience of coming up to the instrumentation lab for their training, for their Apollo training, learning how to use the sextant to be able to do an optimal alignment with the IMU required of reinitialization.
And they're uniformly extremely impressive people.
Oh, yeah.
Just as they were in the 60s, they really give you that sense of just real command of the system. So we have a couple of weeks of kind of introductory thinking. Next week, Thursday, getting a little bit more deeply into the overview of the system and how we're going to think about it as a complex system. Then a little bit in how do we think in general about engineering systems in this context. Again, not least of it is the Phil Scranton article is really great. It's just the industrial side. You know, people talk now about private spaceflight, but every single piece of hardware was made by a private company in Apollo. Who were those companies? What were they doing? What was their business? Then we'll talk about Atlas. We're off the 19th. Larry's going to talk about Sputnik, Mercury, and the Cold War on the 21st. John Tilko will come talk about the Kennedy decision, particular interest of his. Again, I emailed Farouk, about 6 weeks ago? I didn't hear anything, and then last night he emailed me, oh, sure, I'll be happy to come. So I don't have a reading yet for him, but we'll find some interesting. Anybody seen the Tom Hanks From the Earth to the Moon series, which is really pretty good? There's a section in it. I'll dig it out, and we'll try to play it in class. And the chapter is called The Mind of Farouk Albaz. And they have a picture of, they have sort of a dramatization of him in his workshop at the time. It's very cool. Maybe we'll watch that. We'll talk about Gemini. We'll do a day on the LOR decision. That's really too bad that we won't have Bob Siemens for that, because we had him in the last time, and you know, he was really the guy who made the decision. So fabulous there. Bill Widnall, do a talk on Apollo guidance and control. Do a day on the LEM. Talk about the landing in detail. That on March 21st, which is the last day before spring break, there is a scheduled quiz that day, and that's because I want you by then to know the basic outlines of the projects. How many flights were there? You know, a couple of key dates. It sounds like rote memorization, but it's critical to really understanding who were some of the crew members, what were some of the backgrounds, and just at that point, you should just know, you know, the Apollo system and the program and the history, the basic outline of it. Then after break, one of the assignments, did I put the, oh, you know what? I think I forgot to put the book review. Oh, no, it is there. It's on that page. So there's a book review due. I'll talk a little bit about what's expected there and what books you might choose. And the idea is to just read one of the, we're reading a lot of pieces of things, and you want to read one thing in detail. Victor McElhaney will do his account. Don Iles will come, gives a great talk about the software engineering part of it. April gets a little more fuzzy for a couple of reasons. First of all, we're still talking to some of the astronauts to try to get them to come in, so I don't want to nail down every single week, because if they're willing to come, I'll have them any day they can come. So things tend to move around a little bit. Maria's going to come in on the 18th, and a lot of those things can be shifted if we need them to do. I also want to give you guys, given that the final projects are group projects, I want to give you some in-class time, because the hardest thing about group projects at MIT is what? Scheduling everybody. But if you're in the class, we know you're free for these couple hours, so it's a good chance to get the time to work on the projects, and Larry and I can help you in those sessions. And then the last couple days are the group projects and the presentations with some wrap-up. So questions about syllabus or? Comments? Larry, anything?
Well, it's obvious, but you must log on to Stellar. I recommend that you look at it at least twice a week before the class, because that's where all the news, the changes, the assignments, and so on take place. I was just trying to check to see if we've got a new classroom. I don't have the answer yet.
Well, we sort of shrunk it to fit this one. We'll see. I'd love to keep this one. It's right across the hall from my office. And we'll see how many people. We always lose a few percent folks in the first couple times. How many of y'all are Course 16 grad students? Okay, so this course is going to be a little different in that it's heavily based on reading. There's a lot of writing. There are no problem sets per se. There is a design project at the end that you're more familiar with. It's really engaging with that material is the key essence of the class. We've chosen the readings carefully. They're pretty interactive in that you think about having a conversation with them. I would suggest strongly reading with a pencil. Reading is not a broadcast medium, it's an interactive medium. Write down questions, highlight key things, bring questions to class by all means, things you disagree with. Always ask yourself, who is the author? Why are they writing this? What is the agenda behind this document? We are reading some primary source documents. Even the historians, when were they writing this? Why was this a history that was commissioned by NASA? Was it a critical history that's independent? Was it commissioned? You know, NASA has a great history office. They commission a lot of histories. We'll read pieces of it, and you can read other parts of it for other parts of your work. And there's, but they don't tend to be all that critical of the agency. Big surprise. So we want to just get as many different perspectives on the project as we can. Sorry,
can you,
Larry.
Can you bring up the last picture?
Sure. I think. This one or the one that's on.
Okay, quick. How much do you know? Now, there are those who say that we never landed on the moon. surprisingly large.
Anybody here don't believe the project existed? I would say I believe it couldn't have been faked because to produce that many documents, there are so many documents in the archives. That would have been just as expensive as you might as well just go there and.
So what's from this picture? What is some of the evidence that we did not land on the moon? What in this picture tells you that the whole business was a fake?
Flag.
Flag. Then what about the flag?
It's extended. It should be just hanging there.
Why?
It's on a plane.
But no. But tell me why it should just be hanging there.
There's no wing.
Okay. Right. So what's going on?
The frame on it.
Yeah, right. The frame. And did I thought the flag on TV, you see the flag waving. How'd that happen?
Spring. It's made of a material which is not as limp as normal fabric is, and actually without air, when you move it, if you were to move like a regular piece of fabric in the wind, or even without a wind, if you're just they're actually turning the thing as they're putting it in the ground, which is causing it to wave. Because there is no air resistance, it waves more than it would have in the presence of air resistance, because the air resistance actually dampens the oscillation.
Okay, that's one. What other evidence from here is that it was faked?
I always hear arguments about the way the shadows are lined up.
Okay, tell us about that. Very clear from this picture.
I don't know much about it, but in some of the other photographs, it appears that the shadows that are being cast by different bodies don't have the same angle. And if there's only one light source, that's the sun, they'd have to be at equivalent angles.
Okay, in some of the other pictures I don't really see here, you can see two shadows, two distinct shadows. Where do they come from?
Reflections. The two shadows come from reflections. They're not lining up as often because the ground isn't flat.
Well, where are the light sources that are caught in the shadows?
Well, reflections from the hills. There's
some of that, but there's the sunshine and there's earthshine, which I think is a considerable part of it. So there's a lot of argument about how could there be two shadows. It must have been because there was the lighting in the studio. okay. What else? What more do I see in this?
No stars. That's a common one.
Yeah. You don't see any stars. What knocks down that argument?
Because he's
bright. It's pretty bright. Okay, how about looking at these foot strips?
So there was one episode of Mythbusters that they said that the footsteps has too much form to it. It should be flat or something. I can't remember the exact argument, but they look weird.
You're close. There's something about the presence of those clear footsteps which supports the conspiracy theory. The footsteps were in the lunar regolith, the dust, right? What should have happened to the dust when the LEM was landing? And you had these big thrusters. You already saw in the pictures that Dave showed at the beginning. We saw the fact that dust was coming up. Why did you mean that there was no dust left? What were they stepping in, and why wasn't that all blown away like a super leaf blower? That's another question. How deep was the dust?
Yeah.
And that's a separate story.
We'll get into that. There's a lot of concern that the thing was just going to sink in this big pool of dust and disappear.
Well, the fact is that probably dust was blown away in the path of the thruster, but not at those points. There was, when I was living in France on a sabbatical some years ago, there was a big French TV program that had a lot of publicity on the subject of how the Washington prepared to cover up in the event that that we didn't successfully land on the moon, and that they had built a large movie studio and got, I want to say, I've forgotten the name of the famous movie director who did... In 2001.
It was a movie, yeah. Kubrick.
And they say they got Kubrick to build a studio and recreate the lunar landing so that they would have something to show in the event that, in fact, it was a disaster. And this movie had interviews with Senator Eagleston, with Henry Kissinger. It had movies with our friend Jeff Hoffman, all of whom were telling little stories that supported this theory that we were faking the whole... my wife turned to me and said, "That's true." I said, "Well, I never heard any of this, but hey, Nixon was president; anything was possible." And it wasn't until the film was over, and after they ran the credits, that then they had these post credit interviews with the subjects who were like Mrs. Kubrick, who saying, "Oh, I really messed up that part where you wanted me to say such and such." Jeff Hoffman never knew that this whole thing was going to be used as part of a giant put on. Anyway, you'll hear from time to time references to the conspiracy theory.
There's a lot of reasons people make conspiracy theories, and we know they don't need a lunar landing to do it. But I think one of the reasons that conspiracy theory survives, it is such a kind of anomalous thing in that we never went back and there are no comparable human experiences in a way. And, the one that I find interesting is that the LEM really doesn't look obsolete in the way that if you looked at a car, much less a computer from those years, it looks like something my parents, maybe your grandparents would have used. But the LEM, because another one's never been built, we don't know what a modern LEM looks like. That's the only one that was ever built. It's to this day, the only spacecraft ever built that operates entirely outside of Earth's atmosphere, the only human-occupied spacecraft. It's still, it's the most modern LEM there is. It's not quite true, because we'll see some of the studies.
The space station within Earth's atmosphere?
Earth's sphere of influence, okay. I think, is the gravity field, you could say. And the space station, the parts. Anybody know what flight that is, by the way? Mm-hmm. I want to guess. It's probably 15, but a good way to think is 15, 16, and 17 were known as the J missions. What was the name of the place they landed on the first flight on Apollo 11? Anybody know? Sea of Tranquility. Why was it named that? It's really big and it's really flat. And it was with 15, 16, and 17 that they got more and more confidence in the targeting, particularly, but generally in the system overall. And they started to go into hairier and hairier areas. And 15 at Hadley Rill, which Dave Scott will talk all about, and I think Farouk will talk about it too. There's always this tension. We used to see this tension in the undersea environment too, is like, you know, you can build a vehicle that'll float around, but when you work with a geologist, they don't want to go to the big open flat places. They want to go to the places where there's volcanoes and stuff all trash, because that's what's interesting scientifically. And that was certainly true here. The geologists were always pushing them to go into bigger and bigger terrain. And the landing, the late landings are really pretty spectacular as far as what they went over and what they got into. Dave will talk about that.
We had dinner last night with Jim Head and his colleague from Russia, Sasha, I just blocked out his last name, mm-hmm. who was responsible for the site selection for the Lunokhod, which was the Soviet unmanned lunar vehicles, and then early planning for the manned vehicles. Mm-hmm. And we talked a lot about site selection criteria, and in the Soviet Union, criteria number 1, 2, 3, and 4 were the same. It was safe, flat, no uncertainty of little craters or boulders or deep lunar dust. And I said, what role did science play in them? None.
How many scientists flew them on?
One.
One. The last guy on the last mission was the one scientist on the moon, Jack Schmidt.
There were others in the Apollo program.
Mm-hmm. Oh, many.
Bob Parker was an astronomer from Caltech.
Big controversy over that too. Maybe we'll talk about that. Because there was a certified pilot who was rejected. I'm trying to remember who it was. It was Joe Engel. Who was an X-15 pilot, actually. The only guy subsequently to fly the shuttle manually through the entire reentry to landing. He was assigned to the flight, and then the National Academy of Sciences and a bunch of other scientific organizations put a lot of pressure on NASA when they knew it was going to be the last one, put a scientist up there, and they switched it, and they sent Jack Schmidt instead, which all kinds of interesting ramifications, because previously they had said you have to be a great pilot in order to go, and this guy was a PhD geologist, and he did a perfectly good job in the right seat. Anybody know what the title in the left seat was? What for the LEM? What was Neil Armstrong's title for the mission? Commander. What was the title in the right seat? Lunar Module Pilot. We'll talk about the moment they switched that from systems engineer or systems manager was the original title. No, you can't be a systems manager and fly to the moon. You have to be a pilot, lunar module pilot. To this day, until a year ago, the space shuttle pilots, in the right seat is the pilot, which is, and in the left seat is the commander, but it's the commander who does the flying. Okay, I think we're good. Just so you know, my office hours, I made them pretty much right after class, and I'm across the hall, so I'll be around if people want to talk.